I now request Mr. Srivatsa Joyce to welcome Dr. Padmini Srinivasan with a bouquet.
And for the firm he was working for. So these three or four things that he saw, he was not able to really leverage his chartered accountancy, and therefore he was looking out for opportunities. And then he decided that instead of doing something else, he should now focus on building the other skills, which was the MBA program. And therefore he joined the MBA program, and the advantage of the CA doing MBA is every term they have a lot of finance subjects, and therefore they are very good at that, whether it's financial accounting or cost accounting or financial management. So all these subjects very easily we are able to crack as chartered accountant. So every term he was able to crack these subjects, get full marks and so on, and that helped him to also get the second rank in the MBA program. Of course today he is working in one of the consulting firms, and very happily settled to understand how he can leverage both CA and MBA for his own betterness. Okay. Of course, broadly, just some statistic that if you look at IIM, not many people pursue MBA from the IIMs. CA is doing MBAs. I think every year we get about 10 to 12% of the MBA candidates are from RCAs with a chartered accountancy background, few with BCOMs and MCOMs. So roughly 10-12% is what we look at, who join the program. And we would obviously like more number of students, CA students particularly, joining the MBA program. That's all I have to share with the students. Thank you.
By the end of this session, I have realized that opportunities are present all around the world. It's up to us to grab it and make the best out of it. I believe this eye-opening session has changed the way we perceive things and our approach towards success. After this session on opportunity and success stories, I take this opportunity to render the vote of thanks for this session. On behalf of Bangalore branch of ICA and Sikasa Bangalore, I thank Dr.CA Padmini Srinivasan for investing her valuable time and efforts in bestowing knowledge upon us. As a token of gratitude and respect, I request Mr. Tony to present a memento as a token of gratitude and respect. Thank you, Tony. And over to Archana and Vedan.
Thank you, Srivatsa.
Namma mitra bandhavarigu dhanyavadagalu.
The higher the risk, the higher the reward. Every risk doesn't ensure the reward. Only the calculated and well-managed risk can get you higher.
To enlighten us more about the concept of risk, we have our next session, Risk Management for an Enterprise and the Role of a Chartered Accountant, by the energetic and distinguished CA Srivatsan Parthasarathy.
So ladies and gentlemen, I request Mr. Sankar Vempati to escort CA Srivatsan Parthasarathy onto the dais. A very warm welcome, sir.
Thank you, Vedant and Archana.
Dear delegates, good afternoon, everyone. The people who succeed are irrationally passionate about something. What do you say? Passionate about something, people will be succeed, right? Yes. Yeah. I'm so pleased to be with you today to introduce the successful person, C.A. Srinivasan Parthasarathy, who is very passionate in risk management. He is head of controllers in India and chief financial officer of Goldman Sachs in Bengaluru. He serves on the Bengaluru Executive Committee, sponsors the Bengaluru People Development Committee, and is a supporter of the LGBT network. He joined Goldman Sachs in 2008 as a vice president and was named managing director in 2011. Before joining the firm, he worked at JP Morgan for more than 13 years in Mumbai, Singapore, and New York in finance and accounting roles, including chief financial officer, legal entity support, and management reporting activities. Earlier in his career, he held finance roles at General Electric, Tata Steel, and UB Group from 1989 to 1995. He is a fellow member of ICAI and graduate at ICWAI. So friends, climbing to the top demands strength, whether it is to the top of Mount Everest or to the top of your career. I am sure that this session is going to be a step in your life to get to the top of your career. With this brief introduction, I am presenting before you C.A. Srinivasan Parthasarathy. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks for this introduction, and thanks, friends. I know I'm between another important agenda for you, which is lunch, and my session on risk. So I'll try to keep it brief and specific so that you can understand what are some of the opportunities that a chartered accountant can in an enterprise or an organization. So, you know, risk, when I kind of qualified as Professor Srinivasan spoke, it was more like, you know, chartered accountants were kind of set to only do accounting work, and you know, it was more like, you know, finalization, audit, and which was largely in the accounting and audit assurance space. And one of the reasons why, when he spoke about my career, how I migrated from, you know, industries into financial service, just to give you a couple of you know, brief background on that. In 1991 or 92, I think India kind of expanded. They became an economy where they wanted to kind of, Manmohan Singh was the finance minister then, so he wanted to kind of make this economy more open, more broader. Concepts like LERMS and things like that came at that time. I was very keen, like all of you, I had qualified by then, and I was interested in understanding what financial is, what financial service. The industry is going to open, the country is going to open, you're going to have a lot of large players coming in. The concept of finance was kind of really opened up by Manmohan Singh to this country. So that was the time when I was really interested, and one of the reasons why I moved away from manufacturing industry to financial service was useful for me. And from then on, it's been more than like close to 23, 24 years I've been in financial service industry. And in the last 20 years, I really learned that as a chartered accountant, what a value can we play in financial service industry, especially during the part of the post-financial crisis. I think our value on what we can contribute to an organization is really immense. With that in mind, I just want to talk to you a bit about risks, and I want you to think more broadly than just, you know, accounting, audit, and tax in terms of where we can play a role in a financial service organization. I feel, as much as Professor Srinivasan spoke on where MBAs can kind of contribute, the post-financial crisis, I really feel if we can understand the concept of risk, we can really play a very valuable role in an industry and in helping them to be more successful. Okay, I just have, sorry, yeah. Okay, so I just have, I'm putting in a page here, just wanted to walk you through briefly what risk is, right? Every event that we do has an action. I mean, every action that we do has an event, and that can be an opportunity or a threat. It's very important for you to for us to understand what it means. What are the downsides as much as whatever the upside could be, right? So broadly, if you see, you can break the risk into three parts: the business risk, non-business risk, and financial risk. I'll briefly explain what business and non-business risks, which some of which were, in the slide that Professor Srinivasan showed, was like, you know, your competition, your industry, where do you stand, some of the threats that clients will kind of throw. Those are some of the things that I would call as business risk. Non-business risks are things that we can't control, which is like, you know, a sudden calamity which has come and affected, or, you know, a fire in the factory which we never kind of anticipated, which is putting down your business. Those are non-business risks. Where I really want to focus is on financial risk, and I feel that chartered accountants can really play a good role in this, and we kind of get secluded and we kind of contain ourselves in financial accounts. If we really kind of spend time to understand what are these, we will be definitely be able to contribute and be more successful. And in our organization, in Goldman Sachs, a lot of chartered accountants work on all of these risks. So broadly, I'll break the risks that is currently we see today into market risk, credit risk, liquidity risk, and operating risk. Mostly post-financial crisis, the last two, liquidity risk and operating risk, have become more important. Traditionally, as much as take every big organization in the world, including our country, were more focused around, I would say that the risk, whatever they called as risk before financial crisis, were largely around at the point of time or historical risk they will evaluate. Never was there a thought about what would happen to future if I kind of impute. You might have seen a lot of movies like, insider trading or margin call, those movies which would have kind of explained you what future risk is. And those were the aspects this financial crisis really taught us as to how one should not only look at what happened in the past, what's currently happening in the industry, but also layer this with what do we see from a future perspective and then impute it. And today I would say the risk and the various regulations that's come through in the world has kind of talking a lot about liquidity, operating, and layering these, imputing the future into your market and credit risk is where we feel that the direction of risk is going. And I really feel that chartered accountants can really add value, because almost all these concepts are kind of taught to us in our curriculum, but we don't try to extend this, right? So what are some of the measures? One is value at risk. Like every day you look at your price. If you go to a stock market, you look at what happens, right? There is a price today, and then every day it gives you, like, you know, what's the past historical price, but you can then impute, if you put in these risk factors, how your future price would be. That's the market value, or what you call as value at risk, right? And then stress testing this. These days, testing these scenarios for future has become very important. Like, you know, what would an event like, you know, 2008 happens, or a 1999 ringgit crisis, or what happens in Venezuela today, or a change in oil prices, how will that impact your commodity or product? Stressing that with your product or the industry that you're doing, that's something that, you know, chartered accountants does in our organization. Of course, counterparty country risk is, like, you know, very straightforward. One can understand how would you impact, depending upon all the various economic situation. The fact that we are going through Brexit, every global organization is looking at what happens if Brexit cuts itself completely. Should I kind of partner with Germany? Should I start putting my business there? What does that mean from a counterparty or a country risk? So those are probably the concepts that are kind of newer and kind of assimilated. And I feel like, you know, we as CAs can really participate in understanding, because all of these are purely financial risk. Most of these are kind of thought. It is very important for you to understand the concept, and so that you can make yourself really good. So as I move towards where chartered accountants are really successful in organizations like Goldman Sachs, before that I want to spend a few minutes to talk to you to say that as you are kind of budding, she said, like, don't spend time just doing dummy articles and just focus on education, right? Because that's definitely, as once you finish your, in my years, it used to be called a CA intermediate. We call it CP2 now, where you finish your first or second term of your this thing. Look at doing your proper apprenticeship in any industry or an organization where you can practically learn these skills, because that is what, if you really want to spend time in industry outside of practice, I think those skills will provide you an exploring opportunity of what that industry or an organization is doing. How can you as a chartered accountant contribute to the risks of that particular organization or industry? And we definitely do that very actively in Goldman Sachs, and not just us, almost more organizations like Morgan Stanley or JP Morgan, all of us do the same kind of stuff. Moving to the right-hand side of the, and before I get into what chartered accountants specifically do in Goldman Sachs, in terms of how, I mean, Professor Srinivasan again spoke a lot about how can you be more successful, how can you become a CFO to CEO, right? I'll pick up today in Goldman Sachs, Bangalore. The COO is a chartered accountant. The head of HCM is a chartered accountant. The COO of technology, who is responsible for $4 billion of the firm's technology spend, is a chartered accountant. CFO is a chartered accountant. And there are many people. So you should look at what the opportunities and how can you carve your path depending upon where your skill set is, where are your strengths, and then you can really make your career. So look at that from that perspective when you're taking an industry and see what your interests are. Now moving on to the right hand, and so we have Goldman Sachs has about 17 or 18 divisions globally, of which 15 of them are in India, and almost all of them, I would say, if not all of them, at least 12 to 13 of them employ chartered accountants. So there is opportunity for us outside of just doing finance and accounting work. And I would spend time on risk, but I'm happy to take time with you if you think there are other areas that you're really interested in, want to know. Now, where do we hire chartered accountants in finance, right? So finance broadly has three parts, right? One is your traditional books and records, maintenance of financial reporting, etc. The second piece is around corporate treasury, which has become the most important aspect post-financial crisis in international firms, because people now look at what is my liquidity and capital that's required. And the whole phase of how you run the business has changed in the last 10 years. When I joined JP Morgan in 1996-97, I was a product controller doing the interest rate products and P&L reporting. And it used to go like, it's okay if the P&L is completed today, 1 week from that time, I can get my daily P&L signed off and given to the business. Gone are the days. Today, post-financial crisis, the business is taking interest to understand, if I do this particular activity or this new transaction or put this humongous trade, what would it mean from a capital perspective? What it would mean from a market risk perspective? Counterparty and credit, if it is a big trade, one can really understand. But the business is now saying, let us calculate that before putting ourselves. So that is a very key change in terms of how businesses started looking at finance, looking at risk. And guess what? We are the guys who can really help them to understand. If you want to do this trade, you see, this is the risk of being in that market. This is the country you're taking the risk. This is the counterparty you're going to take the risk against. Let's take, if you're going to do it with a company which has got a AAA rating or a double A rating kind of situation. And if you impute all that, your capital that's required. So let's put if you're going to put $100 million into this business, I think you are going to keep $5 million as cost of doing this business. Now tell me what's your margin. I'm just giving you hypothetical numbers, okay? Don't take it literally. So tell me what's your margin that you're going to make, and are you profitable? So imagine, you as a chartered accountant can really help in each and every facet, moving away from just a bookkeeper or a bean counter of just assimilating once the trade is done, to be moving into helping the business to say, putting this trade is going to help you do these things. And I think it is very important for you to understand whether to do this business or not. And that's where I wanted to encapsulate, saying that we are not accountant, but we are risk managers. And that's primarily where you should think of yourself, saying that, I have moved from not just being a supporter of the business to being part of the decision making of the business. Today, most of our decisions, most of the capital investment that bigger organizations do, look risk in this way, so that we don't put, and we have, every organization learns, right? Look, in the last 100 years, there's been more than 8 crises, right? So we are still learning. I'm not saying what we saw 10 years ago is going to be the last crisis. There will be a newer crisis, right? But whenever there is a new product, new market, new investment that we are looking to, we need to convert ourselves to be the part of the decision maker than being a guy who is like counting the numbers and providing it, saying, this is where you made. And that is the sea change that's happening in the business, and that's where I see the opportunity for us moving. Now, moving on to the right-hand side of the page. So in our organization, we have more than 90% of my division are chartered accountants, okay? So all of them, I do have about 5 or 10 people. Some are MBAs and some are postgrads and others who are specialized in certain kind of risk. But bulk of the guys I hire are chartered accountants. And I feel that it's a great opportunity for us to convert and be more in this risk space. So what are we do? So we kind of do product controllers. Product controllers are people who look at the performance of the business day in and day out. At the end of the day, when the trader finishes his business or trade, we take the numbers and go back to him and say, you did this trade assuming you will make this kind of a profit or loss, but your books and records show this this is if you think you made X or Y, your books and record is showing a different number or the same number, and the next day morning we get it signed. We tell him, by holding this position, you made this profit by buying or selling, and by holding this position, we expect you to make this X or Y as loss tomorrow. So that the business is understanding, before the next day morning he gets into the business, he knows what's the profit or loss situation that he's sitting on, and depending upon the market movements, he's able to take a call or not. We hire chartered accountants to do this, and they are the guys who do the daily risks and daily product and daily business P&L for the various businesses and markets, both locally and globally. Legal entity controllers, I said that the post-financial crisis, with all the various regulations, both locally and globally, management of capital has become very important. Management of your entity on a proactive basis has become very important in terms of looking at what is the cash that is there and how much of that would be available for the kind of inventory or the business that you're kind of carrying. And doing that has become, especially for global organizations like us, regulators have asked us to do, post the too big to fail story, they have told us it's not necessary. I mean, earlier global organizations can book their business anywhere they want. You know the regulations as per GAR. You know how countries have become territorial. The regulators are asking, which entity are you booking this business? And the local regulators, so for example, a global organization, Goldman Sachs, if they have got their capital in US and they want to trade globally in China or in Korea or in India or Russia or UK, they need to define which is the business that they are going to do, which is the entity that they are doing, and they want to make sure that that entity is well capitalized to make sure they can withstand the crisis. The whole concept of stress testing, CCAR, and all those things have evolved and made us started looking and adding some respect to what the financial statements that we put as for each and every individual legal entity. And so we hire chartered accountants to determine what should be the capital of this business. Tomorrow, when an event like Brexit happens and you want to kind of migrate the businesses that you do in a particular country to another European country, what are the opportunities of doing? How would you capitalize that entity? What is the necessity as per those regulations, and how will you kind of respond to that? Those are some of the stuff that the legal entity controllers do. Funding, as I mentioned, has become the most, if there is one risk that has changed post 2008, it's the liquidity risk. Today, every regulator wants to know, for the positions and the business that you do, how well are you positioned to manage your business without disturbing your capital or money that you have kept as dedicated reserves for doing your business from 0 to 30 days, 6 months and 9 months, depending upon the breadth of your inventory or the length of your inventory, and they want to make sure that liquidity is really. So there are very model-driven concepts that are evolved, and that is something that we hire our chartered accountants to do this work. I mean, regulatory is very straightforward. As I said, doing your counterparty, country risk, looking at the whole area in terms of your stress situation, your CCAR situation, is all done by regulatory controllers, and we hire chartered accountants for that as well. Financial reporting, not but the least, is putting the consolidated, statutory statements for both your regulators, depending upon which markets do you operate in, whether it is capital market or a bank, so on and so forth. So these are probably the areas where finance is kind of hiring chartered accountants. Outside of that, we also have chartered accountants, as I said, in other divisions, but largely around corporate treasury, taxation, portfolio managers. We hire chartered accountants for managing portfolios in the fund business that we have, and then risk division, largely in market risk and credit risk as well. And then last but not the least is in internal audit. So largely, I would say, as you evolve, think about what are the other horizons that you can look at outside of, if you're looking at industry, outside of just in audit and assurance or accounting, accounting and bookkeeping. These are the areas where I feel chartered accountants are really evolving. Most of these organizations do tend to value the fundamental knowledge that we acquire in terms of understanding the balance sheet and P&L. The only area that we don't kind of try to spend time on is understanding the risks that is there, because most of the time we are taught to kind of look at balance sheet, look at cash flows, look at ways and means and the P&L of the organization. But it's very important for you to combine that along with what is the business that they are doing. Put on the add in the economic risk for it, both for historical and future, and if we bring those things together, we will be able to be more powerful and potentially useful, you know, individual for the organization. And most of the successful guys in our organization, where they have branched into other divisions, have kind of employed this in their own career, and that's why they've been successful. That was a short spiel on where, you know, chartered accountants can be really useful in the risk space in enterprise and industry. But I'm happy to take any question, or you know, the organizers here have my email ID. Feel free to kind of reach me at any point of time for any questions or clarifications you may have. And before I part, I just want to thank you for giving me this opportunity, and also remember that you don't take your articleship very lightly, because good organizations, big organizations, if they want to hire good chartered accountants, they want to see what your experience and your practical knowledge is. For that, I would say, take the apprenticeship or the internship opportunity that the CA Institute provides, and try to join a good organization where you can gain that practical experience, which you can put in good stead for your own career. Thanks.
Yes. Risk is one of the most important thing every chartered accountant should know about that. Isn't it? Yes. Thank you very much, sir, for giving an elaborate explanation and sharing your knowledge and experience about risk management with us, and giving various ideas and to develop your articleship. We should, like sir said, now we should give efforts from now in the articleship to join in the big organizations and to grow our career. Thank you very much, sir. After listening to this wonderful session and witnessing your response, I really recall saying that for a good approach, always there will be a good response. On behalf of Bangalore branch of ICAI and Sikasa Bangalore, I would like to thank our session chairman, C.A. Srinivasan Parthasarathi. I request Mr. Siva to present a memento to C.A. Srinivasan Parthasarathi as token of gratitude and respect. Thank you. Over to Vedant and Archana.
Thank you, Shankar.
After feeding your brain with motivation and knowledge, it's time to feed your stomach. We have arranged really yummy lunch.
Please gather back at the auditorium at exactly 2:30 p.m.
Let's give her a few minutes to speak about it.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. Had your delicious lunch? No? Why? Okay. First of all, my name is Manasa. I'm not here to speak about a matter related to subject. I am here to say a few words related to success. All of you here, do you want to get success? Come on, repeat. Actually, why did you came for this conference? Did you gain anything from coming to this conference? What? If not, you have chosen the profession as a CA. Could you have gained anything by choosing the profession CA? Actually,
thanks,
every profession has its own dignity. Our CA profession has giving an opportunity for us, which is useful in future. Actually, this is the gift given by us as present here are the future chartered accountants. The profession we have chosen, CA, is a boon given by God.
The Thanks, thing Mala, I need to sir. Speak is... Thank you for your speech. Thank you so much. Till down as early as possible. Please settle down soon. Guys, here we have the crazy selfies taken by you people. Enjoy.
After about an hour, after an hour. It'll continue during tea break. Meanwhile, please do take selfies and send us. In the break. Selfies, and we'll tell you the number post the session.
We will now start with the next session. Archana, do you know the number of standards that are currently present?
Yes. Our CA profession mainly go through four types of standards. That is accounting standards, secretarial standards, and newly introduced Indian accounting standards and standards on auditing.
Yes. The Ind AS are of great importance to our profession. Hence, an auditor should be well aware of the accounting standards as well as the Indian accounting standards.
To guide us about the key difference between the accounting standards and Indian accounting standards, we have with a very dynamic and knowledgeable being, CA Mohan R. Levy.
To carry on with the event, may I request Mr. Manoj to escort our session chairman, CA Mohan R. Levy, along with the student speakers, Varsha Jain B. and Ayana Acharya, onto the dais. I now request Mr. Manoj to present our session chairman and student speakers with a bouquet. Over to you, Manoj.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, I can't hear, guys. Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Success is the result of perfection, hard work, learning from failure, loyalty, and persistence. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce such successful person and the session chairman, CA Mohan R. Levy, sir. CA Mohan R. Levy is a member of ICAI with a work experience of more than 28 years. He has worked in senior positions in finance, manufacturing, and software companies. At present, he is a partner with KP Rao & Co. Chartered Accountants, Bangalore, and heads the Ind AS and GST practices of the firm. Mohan is author of first book on service tax that was published in 1994. He has authored books on IFRS, Ind AS, the SOX Act. He is a regular contributor of articles to Hindu Business Line and Deccan Herald on accounting standards, taxation, and GST. Mohan has spoken at various conferences in India and abroad on accounting standards, IFRS, SOX, and GST. And he is a faculty member of ICAI and other professional bodies. Dear friends, let's welcome him with a big round of applause. Now, I would like to introduce student speakers. Our first student speaker, E. Ayanna Achari. He is pursuing his articleship in KPMG. He is confident with his positive attitude and known for time management. He has secured 5th rank in pre-university. He was the winner of Best Student for the year 2013. He got Rising Star Award in KPMG within 6 months of joining the firm. Our second student speaker, Varsha Jain B. She is pursuing articles in HC Kincha & Co. Bangalore. She is very good with her interpersonal skills and known for her focus and determined execution of plans. She has secured 10th rank in pre-university. She has participated in various games like chess and secured many medals. Let's welcome both the student speakers with a big round of applause. I request Mohan sir to take over the session. Thank you.
So, good afternoon, everyone. One of the advantages of being a session chairman is you don't have to speak too much. Right? So, I'm just going to sort of give a little bit of background because I think it's only fair that the student speaker should be speaking the most in a session like this, wherein they're talking about the differences and all those things. But I just want to give you a little bit of a background before they can take over. We're talking about the Ind AS versus the AS differences. This effort to converge our present accounting standards to Ind AS has been happening for quite some time in India. In fact, the International Accounting Standards Board, in 2006, they were on a global tour to promote IFRS, because 2004 IFRS was implemented all across Europe. And in 2006, they thought it was fit to come to India, because they said, you have got a lot of software companies, you've got a lot of pharma companies, exports, and you also have a lot of controversial companies. So, you know, you should probably implement IFRS. So the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, they were looking at all the advantage which the IASB thought India has got is because we are already following, your present IAS is modeled on the International Accounting Standards, IAS. So they were saying since the IAS has become IFRS, it should not really be a problem for India to move over to IFRS. This was their thinking. So when they came to India and laid out all the standards, the Indian government, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, as the case may be, said that we are okay with the IFRS, it's good. We don't have no problem in implementing IFRS, apart from one particular standard. You please remove that standard and we will follow IFRS. That standard was called IAS 41 Agriculture. The Indian government's or the MCA's thinking was agriculture in India, they don't pay income tax, no GST, no VAT, nothing. Probably no books of account also. So how can they have international financial reporting standards? That was their thinking. So the IASB was obviously very disappointed. And from Delhi, I remember they were on a global tour. From Delhi, they went to Karachi. And they went and asked Pakistan, will you implement IFRS? Pakistan asked them, from where are you coming? They said, we are coming from India. Then the next question was, did India implement IFRS? Pakistan, this IASB said, no, they are having some problems with IAS 41, so they are not going to implement IFRS. Pakistan said, no, we will implement, don't worry. In 2006, without a roadmap, without any this thing, they simply went over to IFRS completely, what is called, you know, probably the military approach to IFRS adoption. Even banks, the State Bank of Pakistan in 2006 presented their financial statements in full IFRS. But of course, subsequently, one more attempt was made in 2011, and finally now we are in the third phase of companies moving to IFRS. So what Varsha and Aina will be talking about are the significant differences, because one is really not sufficient time to talk about all the differences, and they have also not going to cover one standard wherein the maximum differences probably lie, which is Ind AS 109 in financial instruments. So that is also, that will take a separate session by itself. So I just thought I should give you this little bit of a brief here. Just to ensure that all of you know about it, the roadmap covers enterprises only with a net worth of up to 250 crores. There is no particular roadmap for enterprises who are below 250 crores. For them, as all of you may be aware, we are revising the present AS itself. AS 2, AS 4, AS 6, 10, 13, 14, 21, 29 have all been revised. Those revisions are almost at par with your IND AS standard. So maybe by 2020, we probably expect that every enterprise in India which follows the accounting standard rules would come to some version of IND AS, either the normal IND AS or the revised AS. So it is important that all of you pay attention to all these differences which are there. There are significant differences, I can tell you that much. There are significant differences and some very subtle differences which, you know, you should probably be aware of. I'm sure that they'll take you through all of them. And just a small correction, the first speaker is going to be Varsha, and then later on, you know, Ayana will join us. So I'm going to hand over the floor to them. Thank you.
Hello friends, good afternoon. We are here to see the key differences between AS and IND AS. So before looking at the key differences, let's have a look at roadmap for implementation of IND AS in India. So India has conversed with international financial reporting standards and has implemented IND AS in two phases, and first of all it has implemented on a voluntary basis from financial year 15-16, thereafter in two phases. That is, from financial year 16-17 for all companies whose net worth is more than 500 crores, holding subsidiary, joint venture and associates of these companies. Thereafter in phase 2 from financial year 17-18 for all listed companies, other companies having net worth more than 250 crores, holding subsidiary, joint venture and associates of these companies. Thus, IND AS has become reality now, with phase 1 and phase 2 companies have already published their financial statements as per IND AS. Now, let's move on to our topic for discussion. So, there are enormous differences between AS and IND AS, but today our focus only would be on these topics. So before that, first of all, let's see the differences in at a macro level. Let's have a macro level analysis of differences in AS and IND AS. IND AS is more focused on substance over form. Say for example, goods normally sold at rupees 100 for 3 months credit period. If sold at rupees 110 for 9 months credit period, then the difference of rupees 10 is considered as interest income as per IND AS. That is, finance element inbuilt in price is segregated and considered as interest income as per IND AS. Further, as per AS, whenever an instrument is to be recognized, it is taken on the contractual agreement basis or whatever it sounds like. Take the example of preference shares itself. Preference shares, irrespective of its nature, is always considered as share capital as per AS. Whereas what IND AS says, redeemable preference shares carrying fixed rate of dividend is to be considered as liability and not equity. This is because it doesn't satisfy the criteria to classify as equity, because there is a contractual obligation to deliver cash or other financial instrument. We can very well compare these redeemable preference shares with the normal loans or borrowings, which is recognized as liability in the financial statements. Thus, having the nature of loans or liabilities, we classify these redeemable preference shares as liability as per IND AS.
So we therefore conclude that Ind AS looks into the substance of the transaction and not just the form. Further, Ind AS are principle-based standards and not rule-based standards. To check this, let's go to the Ind AS 110 and AS 21 consolidated financial statement, where it defines the word control. Control as per AS 21 is, an entity is said to have control over another entity by directly or indirectly purchasing more than 50% of voting power or by controlling the composition of board of directors. Whereas Ind AS requires the exposure or rights over the variable return and the ability to affect those variable returns. It also requires substantive right to control the relevant activities of the investee. I know these statements are so complicated, right? So let's see the example to understand the same. There are three companies, A Limited, B Limited and C Limited. A Limited has 51% voting power in C Limited, whereas B Limited has 49% voting power in C Limited. There also exists a shareholders agreement between A Limited and B Limited, which says no activity in C Limited could be carried out without the consent of both A Limited and B Limited. So this is a scenario. Now let's check out the control as per AS and Ind AS. As per AS 21, only A Limited has control over C Limited because it satisfies the criteria of having more than 50% of voting power. Whereas Ind AS 110 says even B Limited has control over C Limited because it has a substantive right to control the relevant activity of C Limited. That is, it looks into the principle of the transaction and not just the rule that it has less than 49% of voting power. So we say that even both A Limited and B Limited has control over C Limited and not just A Limited. Therefore, we conclude that Ind AS are principle-based standard and not just rule-based. Now, let's move into the changes in form and components of financial statement as per Ind AS. Before that, I would like you all to please recall the AS balance sheet. I know, obviously, you all would be knowing, but just recall so that we could be able to understand the changes in the financial statement as per Ind AS. Division 2 of Schedule 3 of Companies Act 2013 prescribes the financial statements as per Ind AS. Part 1 is balance sheet. Ind AS balance sheet starts with assets, then followed by equity and liability. So in the assets part, we can see that there is a removal of the head fixed asset. Further, a new heading has been, the tangible assets has been renamed as property, plant and equipment. Investment property has been newly introduced on the face of the balance sheet. Further, disclosure of goodwill has been separated from other intangible assets. Biological assets other than parent plants have been shown on the face of balance sheet. There is an introduction of new heading financial assets and clubbing of some items like investments, trade receivables, loans under the new head financial assets. We also have a current tax asset, a new entry coming on the face of balance sheet. The next part, equity and liability. Shareholders' fund and share capital has been renamed as equity and equity share capital. Reserves and surplus has been renamed as other equity. Further, there is a new heading coming over here is financial liability. We saw financial assets on the asset side and now financial liability in the liability side. Then clubbing of some items under the new head financial liabilities. Further, there is one new entry that is current tax liability. We saw current tax asset in the asset side and current tax liability here on the face of balance sheet. Now let's go to statement of changes in equity. The statement of changes in equity as per Ind AS is on line with IFRS with two parts, equity share capital and other equity. So let's see the statement of other equity. It has a 12 columns, and we could see that the second column is share application money pending allotment. It was there on the face of balance sheet as per AS balance sheet, whereas as per Ind AS it has been shifted to other statement of other equity. Then the column number 3 is equity component of compound financial instrument. In that, the main part is the instruments include convertible preference shares and debentures. Column number 5 and 6 are debt and equity instrument through other comprehensive income. This reflects the change in fair value of the instruments which are valued through other comprehensive income. We'll see what is other comprehensive income and we'll see the statement of profit and loss account. The below part of this statement of changes in equity is like a appropriation account. Then part 2 of division 2 is statement of profit or loss account. The statement of profit and loss account as per Ind AS is one statement with two sections. Section 1 is profit and loss for the period and section 2 is majorly of other comprehensive income. We could see that the first section has no major changes except that the profit or loss from discontinuing operation has been renamed as profit or loss from discontinued operations. The second section is majorly covered by that other comprehensive income. What is other comprehensive income? It's basically your income, expense, gains or losses which are not yet realized to the entity. Further, the presentation of it has to be bifurcated in two parts. The items which will not be reclassified to profit or loss account and the items which will be reclassified to profit or loss account. Which will not be reclassified to profit and loss account, example, revaluation surplus, and which will be reclassified to is the foreign exchange difference arising from the foreign operation. This is the example just which will come under this head. The taxes relating to these incomes or gains also will be presented in this part itself. The second major change in this part is the earnings per share. EPS has to be shown separately for continuing operation as well as discontinued operation, and we have to also present it in a clubbed, that the total EPS also has to be presented in the statement of profit or loss account. So these are the changes in form and component of the financial statement. It has improved the transparency and comparability of the financial statement, thereby giving a bulk of information to the stakeholders on the face of financial statements so that they can take the financial decision quickly. Now let's go to the differences between AS1 and Ind AS1. Disclosure of accounting policy versus presentation of financial statement. As the name itself suggests, the scope of the AS1 is narrow, whereas scope of Ind AS1 is broader as it covers the presentation of entire financial statement. There is no concept of other comprehensive income as per AS1, whereas Ind AS1 gives us the how to deal with the other comprehensive income and gives the guidance. We just now saw how to present the other comprehensive income in the statement of profit or loss account. Then AS1 has has a extraordinary item as a heading in the statement of profit or loss account, whereas Ind AS1 has completely striped off this topic. Then Ind AS1 says the expenses to be classified based on the nature of expenses. This is a specific restriction as per Ind AS, whereas AS1 has no specific restriction as such. Now I'll be giving you a scenario and I want some answers from you, just a yes or no type. So then I'll put a statement. You have to give me, is this a valid statement and it is related to the scenario. Let's take a company. What has the company? The company has prepared its financial statement, and at the time of finalization of financial statement, the company realized that it has not considered one of the standard in its financial statement, and the effects of those standard has not been given in the figures in the financial statement. So what the management did, it has disclosed the same in its notes to accounts stating that so-and-so standard is not considered while preparing the financial statement, and the effects of the same are not given in the figures mentioned in the financial statement. Now I want to answer from you guys whether the company is correct in its disclosure. Can the company do so? If yes, why? And if no, why? Yeah. Yeah, I will put it in a statement. The Ind AS 1 says disclosure, mere disclosure is not a remedy for wrong accounting. The company cannot contend that though it has not followed the Ind AS, but it has disclosed in its financial statement that the Ind AS has not been followed. This will not rescue company from the consequences of violation of Ind AS. I want to quote one more point related to this is, even the auditors has to qualify its accounts. The auditor cannot say that a company has followed entire Ind AS except this topic, because this statement is given in Ind AS 1, then the company has violated Ind AS itself. Ind AS 1 has not been followed, because disclosure is not a remedy for wrong accounting, it is given in Ind AS 1. Let's go to second Ind AS, AS 4 versus Ind AS 10, contingencies and events occurring after balance sheet date and events occurring after reporting date, Ind AS 10. AS 4 requires the disclosure of non-adjusting event in the board of directors report, whereas Ind AS 10 requires the same in the financial statements. Therefore, we say the new set of accounting standards are enhanced disclosure standards. It requires a lot of disclosures in the financial statements. Further, if the fundamental basic assumption of going concern is not appropriate, AS 4 says you need to adjust the assets and liabilities. Whereas Ind AS 10 says the basis of accounting itself has to be changed if the fundamental basic assumption of going concern is not appropriate. AS 4 doesn't mandate to disclose the date of approval, or it doesn't need, AS 4 don't specify that the disclosure of date of approval in the financial statements, whereas Ind AS 10 says that we should disclose the date of approval in the financial statements. Ind AS 10 doesn't deal with contingencies. The next Ind AS or AS is AS 22 and Ind AS 12, accounting for income taxes and income tax related standard. So as per AS 22, the deferred tax is to be calculated based on income statement approach, whereas Ind AS 12 specifies the balance sheet approach. We'll understand what is income statement approach and balance sheet approach, and then we'll come back to the same slide. We'll look at an example to understand the income statement approach and balance sheet approach. Let's say there is an asset. The cost of the asset is 1 lakh rupees as per accounting records and 1 lakh rupees as per tax record. Depreciation is 10,000 as per accounting records and 20,000 as per tax records. Thereby, written down value is 90,000 and 80,000 respectively, accounting records and tax records. So now let's see what is income statement approach. The income statement approach takes the difference of the depreciation, that is 20,000 minus 10,000. Let's take 30% is the tax rate, or the 30% is applied on the difference of 10,000, and we calculate 3,000 of deferred tax liability. Whereas balance sheet approach takes the difference of WDV. We call in Ind AS the carrying amount, the difference of carrying amount and tax base, that is 90,000 minus 80,000. 30% is the tax rate, we'll apply on the difference of 10,000, 30%, the ultimate answer is 3,000. So looking at this example, we conclude that there is no difference between income statement approach and balance sheet approach, right? Right? No difference between income statement approach and balance sheet approach. Yes or no? No! How can yes? See, there is a difference between... Yeah, there is a difference maybe the ultimate answer is tax neutral, but the way of getting answer is different in both the approach. Because in income statement approach, we just consider the difference of depreciation. Here I can again prove that the Ind AS are principle-based standard and not just rule-based standard, because the balance sheet approach says the difference in WDV. Why does it take the WDV difference, that is carrying amount and tax base? It explains like that, ki as we are getting rupees 90,000 of benefit in it in the remaining period of the asset, that is 10,000 rupees of extra benefit, on that extra benefit we are liable to pay extra tax of 3,000 rupees. Thus we recognize a liability of tax of rupees 3,000, and this is the logic behind the balance sheet approach, whereas there is no logic behind the income statement approach. We just take a difference of depreciation. So let's go back to the same slide to understand the other differences. AS 22, while calculating the deferred tax asset, it applies the prudence rigorously. It has a rigorous application of prudence, because it says you are allowed to recognize deferred tax asset only when there is a reasonable or virtual certainty supported by some convincing evidence. It is very stringent on the matter that you are not allowed to recognize a deferred tax asset unless you have any rigor or reasonable or virtual certainty of the income in future. Whereas Ind AS 12 is quite lenient on that, and it says even if the company is probable, they can recognize a deferred tax asset. Further, changing tax status situation is not dealt in AS 22, whereas Ind AS has a guidance on how to deal with changing tax status situation. There is a guidance in AS 22 where to deal with the tax holiday situation and the situation where 115JB of Income Tax Act applies, that is MAT provision apply. Whereas such guidance we don't find in Ind AS 12. Why so? Because these situations are companies country specific. Whereas Ind AS is a global standard, adoption of the global standard, and it doesn't contain any country specific situations. These are the differences between some Ind AS, and we also had some macro level analysis of differences. We also looked at the changes in form and components of financial statements because of the implementation of Ind AS. The other differences would be dealt by my co-speaker, Mr. Ayana. Before listening to him, it's an interesting Ind AS he will be going to deal with. But before that, let's have a brief about the impact analysis of implementation of Ind AS in India. International Financial Reporting Standards is viewed as a global standards. More than 100 countries have already conversed or implemented Ind AS in its countries. Its implementation in India has improved the comparability and benchmarking of Indian companies' financial statements with the global peers, thereby improving the accessibility of Indian companies to the global capital market. Ind AS is still a baby stage, and we as a future chartered accountant have a great ahead to deal with its complexities in its young age. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak on this topic. Over to my co-speaker, Mr. Ayana.
ಚಾರ್ಟರ್ಡ್ ಅಕೌಂಟೆಂಟ್ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿನಿಯರ ಸಮ್ಮೇಳನಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗಮಿಸಿರುವ ಎಲ್ಲ ನನ್ನ ಸಹ ಚಾರ್ಟರ್ಡ್ ಅಕೌಂಟೆಂಟ್ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿನಿಯರಿಗೆ ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು. ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ಮೈ ಕೋಸಿಯ ಆಸ್ಪಿರೆಂಟ್ಸ್. ಟೆಂಪರರಿ ಪ್ಲೆಜರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಲೀಡ್ ಟು ಪರ್ಮನೆಂಟ್ ಪೇನ್.
Temporary pain will lead to permanent pleasure. Today, I have got this wonderful opportunity to introduce this esteemed personality, Dr.CA Padmini Srinivasan. She is the chairperson at post-graduation program MBA at Indian Institute of Management, Bengaluru. She is a PhD from National Law School of India University. She is a chartered accountant, a company secretary, and she also holds a master's degree in commerce. She is a faculty at IMB, and she is also a committee member at Center for Corporate Governance at IIMB. She has an industry experience of more than 15 years. She has served as consultant for various organizations, and she has expertise in the areas of corporate governance practices. With this brief introduction, I request all of you to join your hands together for Dr.CA Padmini Srinivasan. Now I hand over the stage to session chairperson, Dr.CA Padmini Srinivasan. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here to see such young faces and students who are very, very still interested in doing CA. Thanks to Mr. Srinivas. Yeah, the reputation is there for the institute, so that's why I'm very happy to see young faces here. Thanks to the organizer and Mr. Srinivas for inviting me and making me come and address the students for opportunities for CA. That's a very, very interesting topic. I thought in my time, CA was the goal. We all had to finish CA and then pursue our journey of chartered accountancy after that. But now I think, as rightly he put yesterday, Mr. Srinivas must have told you that life doesn't just end with CA. CA is just the beginning, and it's a long journey, and we have to keep upskilling ourselves. First of all, I want to start on two or three aspects of what we were doing many years and how we have moved and changed over the last 20, 30 years. Looking at young people, I almost feel very ancient. I think I must be one of those, I don't know if there's anyone who graduated in 1984 CA, anyone in the room. So probably I'm very ancient in that respect. Okay. Very rightly put, my journey as a chartered accountant started in 1984, and I'm reminded of George Bernard Shaw when he said, those who can do, do. Those who cannot do, go for consulting. So initially for about 14 years, I was in the industry in various roles and so on. And then after that, I moved to practicing CA. So I extend George Bernard Shaw to the next level where he said, those who can teach, those who can do, do. Those who cannot do, do consulting. And those who can neither do nor consult will go for teaching. So this is the third phase of my journey where I found a very good opportunity that, after my industry stint and practice, I found a nice niche where I could teach. And of course, I did my PhD and moved for teaching. And now I'm in the fourth phase. And this phase, I call it like this, those who can neither do, nor who can consult, nor who can teach, will preach. So I'm, whatever I tell you, you can use it from my experience, where I have gone through and so on, and maybe you can use it to your own calling. Broadly, what I wanted to also talk to you about is the journey of chartered accountancy. Sometimes, what happens is we are so engrossed in just passing the exam, we lose out on many aspects of the other aspects of our career and so on. And therefore, when you look at chartered accountancy, like I said, that it is a beginning. So the question is, what should we do after CA? And therefore, my talk is relevant from that perspective. So if you look at traditional opportunities, we know that we can work in industry or we can practice and so on, and various areas where you can work in the industry as well as practice. So you have corporate finance, you have treasury, information system audit, internal audit, statutory audit. You can work as a tax consultant. And some of the interesting areas now that have come up is forensic audit. Now, I don't know if you have heard about this new terminology, and that is a very, very exciting area with so much of frauds going around in the country. This forensic audit has become a very, very interesting area of practice for many chartered accountants. Of course, upcoming areas include insurance, risk management, insolvency professionals, and so on. Again, valuation is a very, very interesting aspect which many chartered accountants take up as part of their career choices. The only interesting aspect that I thought in all these aspects is at the end of this journey, your aspiration is to become a CFO, and that's where you think all these leads to. Now, the question is this enough? You know, you have a nice aspiration, you are in your domain knowledge, and this domain knowledge is also quite deep in that sense, and you end up at a very, very high level of post called the CFO, and it's a good thing that we are in our profession. But the more important thing is this enough? You know, today in this context of what we are studying, is it enough that we look at only at the CFO position? Is it enough that we just finish our CA and go about doing our regular practice, etc.? I think that there is a challenge. And the challenge is because of technology that is coming into the world. Okay, so several changes that are happening in the industry is quite threatening to our profession, particularly if you see things like accounting. In fact, a few multinational companies have outsourced their accounting. So accounting is also not practiced in their own organization. It is outsourced to many of the smaller firms or smaller other subsidiaries and stuff like that. So where are we as a chartered accountant heading to? What else do we need to do? Where else we need to strengthen our skills and so on? And therefore, I thought today my focus should be from the perspective of, let's look at how we should improve ourselves by having a holistic business acumen. Okay, and that is where I bring into this talk, that as a chartered accountant, once you finish, why not you look at a career as MBA? Okay, so it's a management career, and you're looking at masters in business administration. So that is what I wanted to propose for the students. Now, I don't want to defect my own profession, because I think CA is a good profession, but if there are other opportunities, you must look at those other opportunities, whether it is legal, whether it is services, or now I'm looking at MBA. And I would think that CA and MBA as a combination is very, very, putting colloquially, a deadly combination, because with several characteristics of a CA, that is our education and our training, is highly useful for the industry as a MBA. So let me just briefly look at how CA will help you and how MBA will help you, and together how you can evolve as a better professional. When you talk about MBA, a campus-like program will help you to look at different perspectives, different facets of business involving different stakeholders and so on. And one of the important aspects is networking. You know, as a CA student, we don't get so much opportunities to network with other students and so on, unless, of course, you come to such conferences and so on. You get very, very rare occasion to network with people who will help you, who will interact with you, with whom you can communicate and also grow with them. So one of the important aspects of an MBA program is also build these networks of people, build networks with other students and so on. That's a very, very important aspect of the MBA program. And of course, be able to assess the problem in a multidimensional way, etc. I'm going to deal with that problem by giving you a small example of a case, what we do and stuff like that. When you talk about MBA, there are wider choices of roles that are available to you. For example, when you look at CA, I have discussed all the aspects of profession. But when you look at MBA, you are not only be capable of doing all the finance roles, but you are also equipped to do other aspects, including consulting, general management role, marketing, supply chain. There is variety of roles that are possible for you to do when you finish your MBA program. So it's not just limited to the finance role or the accounting role or the audit role. You can move from all these finance related roles to the other roles in organization. Particularly one of the important aspects of the MBA program in IIM Bangalore or other place is consulting. So students always seek for how to join a consulting firm and so on. So that is one good training that we give to our students that they are able to handle consulting roles. So not only just finance, consulting, sought after marketing roles, including companies like Hindustan Lever and others, when you want to look at, where else you can apply your skills. Broadly, when you look at CA MBA, let's see where is the difference and what you have gained from both the professions. Now, if you look at the CA, typically we are looking at the curriculum, and these are mainly focused on taxation, audit, accounting, and compliance. So compliance, has a very, very important role in a CA's life, and therefore we look at our profession from that perspective. And I don't know about in my time, we are slightly different, but in your time, I believe you only focus on the exam point of view, and therefore the kind of knowledge that you gain is more focused towards solving the exam questions and so on, losing out the broader perspective of learning. Okay, so that is one thing that I wanted to also talk to you about in the sense, please always look at a broader perspective and not just exam focus. Of course, exam focus is more important. We don't want to be chartered accountants when we are middle-aged. We want to be chartered accountants very quickly. The second part is the advantage of a CA is your orientation to details. So this is very, very important because if you look at, for example, the tax, I remember several years back I was in one of these forums. And one of the students asked the panel member some question, and he said, "Sir, how about this deduction under Section 10? And that's it. The panel member just blasted, and he said, "Now you understand why there is only 3 or 5% pass percentage, because Section 10 does not deal with deduction, it deals with exemptions." So when you talk about what you have learned, orientation to details are very important. So you are building your skill to details. The tax is the best example of that detail. How you go about doing or solving your problems and stuff like that. Secondly, we are also used to understanding the law. So whether it is a general law or taxation law or accounting standards, accounting rules. So rule following is again a very, very interesting aspect of our CA career. More importantly, of course, there's a lot of hard work that goes into it. But there is a small drawback which I find, which I also had in myself, which is we are a little modest. I don't know if it is true with the younger generation, but it was very true with my generation that we were very modest. If you made me stand in front of the mic like this, I can speak hours together on Indian accounting standards and taxation, but if you ask me to speak on some general topic, I would be wondering what I should be able to speak or not. So problem is, one is by nature we are conservative, by nature we are modest, by nature we are not outgoing, and therefore those are the small limitations that we find because of our profession. Of course, it may not be true to that extent in today's generation, but I think that is one of the both the pluses and minuses of our profession. When you go towards the four facets of the accounting profession, you will find that we use all these capabilities whenever any financing and other decisions are taken. We use this facet very well. Okay, so whether we are looking at how to operate the finance department or how to strategize the performance, how to comply with the laws and so on, we have an excellent understanding and capability. However, we find that there is a fundamental flaw in that, and more importantly, What the CA profession gives us is a fly vision. I don't know if you know how flies, you know, the fly, the small fly that we have, what kind of vision it has. Does a fly fly very high? It cannot fly very high. But at the same time, it's easy to, is it easy to swat a fly? Is it easy to kill a fly? No, it's very difficult, right? Because it has a, it has a kind of a vision that is very, very grounded. It has a very, very well-grounded vision that it's able to execute things in on ground. Okay, so chartered accountancy is like that, that gives us a fly vision. In the sense, it is able, we are able to do hands-on, we are able to solve problems that are more hands-on and stuff like that. Whereas, when you look at what is needed for today's generation is not only be able to solve the ground realities, problems that we face, or execution of things, it is also important for us to have an eagle-like vision. Do you see eagle flying closer to the ground? No. You always see eagle is flying above, you know, so many hundreds of feet above us. Okay. So eagle vision is important. It is able to see even the smallest thing on the ground. So while it is good to have a fly vision, we also want to have an eagle type vision, which tells us how to run an organization. And that skill is given to you by the MBA program. So when you talk about the MBA program, it gives you a broader perspective. It gives you an overview of how the organization is, what are the key aspects of the organization, how do we look at organization goals, our vision, mission, and so on. And of course, a broader stakeholder engagement. And when we talk about stakeholder, we talk about our customers, we talk about our suppliers, we talk about environment, we talk about a whole lot of people when we talk about stakeholder engagement. And we work in collaborative teams, and that training is given right from day one. When you talk about case studies, when you talk about group projects and so on. So the MBA program of this kind offers a collaborative team work situation. And of course, they are more risk-taking and so on. And when you look at the primary difference is client versus cost. As a CA, we are always focused on the cost management, how to reduce costs, how to look at finance in a particular manner, versus how to look at things in a broader perspective. Now, four areas, focus areas where MBAs do better is they have a very, very strong focused skills that they develop in terms of leadership of the business. So you have a CFO and you want to become a CEO, the main skill that we need to look at is the leadership development qualities. The other is, of course, the international accreditation that many of these institutions give, and they bring in a global perspective. So many of the case studies that we bring into the class is more based on global perspective, how you know you can look at things from an international business perspective and so on. So broadly, these are the differences that I thought we should look at when you look at CA versus MBA. And of course, it's very, very important that MBA, you know, this is of course based on the research, now since I'm coming from the academic background, that the MBA is still remains the most sought after qualification for managers and leaders. And if you want to be in board sometime, apart from CA, looking at MBA is always useful for us. Okay, curriculum-wise, I think, you know, I just want to give you a small insight into how a CA would deal with this versus how an MBA would deal with this. So this is a small case study, I mean, in a one-slide case, so he can also answer this question. See, there are three friends who want to join and want to start a new enterprise. One of them has a technical capability, second one has bought customers, and third one is going to bring the funding. The question is, how will you allocate the capital? You know, in what ratio, what proportion? Anybody wants to try this? A simple answer would be equally. You have some other insights? But when you go to an MBA, you answering this question will be very, very difficult because you will bring in a lot of other perspectives. Each one of these partners would be thinking about how the business will run without one or the other. Okay, similarly, they would be looking at many other aspects whether it's funding or technology. So how to decide this initial capital will be a very, very crucial challenge for that. Okay, so we run a full case study on just these three lines of question. More interestingly, I just also want to leave you with this case study, which is like a Robin Hood case. You know Robin Hood? Yeah, he was a person who robbed the rich to pay the poor, and he established himself in a jungle, and more and more people joined him and his team so that they could fight these wealthy people in whichever country they were in, and so on. Now, we run a complete case study of two sessions on understanding what should Robin Hood do at a particular stage, because at this point in time, the funds are dwindling, and they waylay the people on the forest, and they used to plunder these people to pay the poor. So since the rich people came to know that these robbers are there on the way, they changed the path, they moved to other ways and so on. So that was a challenge for the Robin Hood. And then, you know, more and more people joined, so there is a lot of quarrel happening between their own members. Okay. So at this situation, the question is, what should Robin Hood do? So that is the kind of situation we deal with, and it's not a very simple solution. So I'll just show you one side, a slide of the solution in terms of what Robin Hood should do in such a situation. Okay. So it is very similar to what organizations do at this stage. For example, there are threats of new entrants, then bargaining power of buyers, bargaining power of sellers, you know, industry rivalry. So we put a framework of strategy here to discuss what Robin Hood should do. Similarly, there could be issues in terms of operations, how he should look at his own team. So there is a question of leadership for him. So multiple facets we develop in the MBA program with one simple case study of Robin Hood. It's just a one-page case, but we talk about various aspects of business and how to manage with this small case study. Okay. So these are the exciting things that we do in MBA, and these are the other aspects which very briefly I covered. You know, when you talk about the strategy part or marketing part or supply chain and stuff like that, how he should manage his food and stuff like that. So a variety of things that you'll do and learn in MBA program, and small case studies like this help you to think deeper and look at a broader perspective of how we should approach our future career. Okay, today, I don't want to name them, but they are also, I think one of them is Central Council member's son. His journey was, he did chartered accountancy, he did company secretary, then but he was always standing second rank. So even in the CA, he was second rank. In his BCom, he was second rank. In the CS, he was second rank. In the CFA, he was second rank. But he said, somewhere I have to crack this, and he decided the option that I have available is MBA. Let me try MBA and get first rank. So he joined IIM Bangalore, and of course, hard work, and became a gold medalist in IIM Bangalore. And of course, today he's working. And immediately after MBA, he joined McKinsey. Then he moved to some other companies, and now he's head of a private equity firm. So I think it's a very, very interesting journey of this student on how he capitalized his strength as a chartered accountant, cracked the MBA, and then moved ahead to look at various career, including consulting, and now, of course, head of private equity. The other student that I also want to talk about is the last year's, he's not a gold medal, but he's the second ranked student of IIM Bangalore. And he finished this year, of course, in the first attempt. And he was, I'm not sure whether he was a rank holder or what he was. And what he did after that, he joined campus placement and moved to Axis Bank. And after 6 months to a year, he understood that some of these prime roles played in front facing, basically looking at interacting with clients and others, he found that these roles are taken up by MBAs. And the other thing that he very importantly missed was his communication skills on how to speak, how to negotiate, how to win deals for himself.
Thank you, Varsha. There was a famous saying, progress without change is impossible. Change makes us grow. Why am I saying this? Come on, why am I saying this? Excellencies, distinguished delegates, and my dear budding chartered accountants, a very good afternoon to one and all present here. Today I am standing before you to present on the massive change which has happened in 2015. Differences between Ind AS has come into picture. So I'll be presenting you the key differences between accounting standards and Indian accounting standards. Okay, before beginning the session, let me ask you one question. Why are we conducting this session? What's in it for us? So there are two major reasons for knowing this differences between accounting standards and Indian accounting standards. Let me tell you the first reason, which is it covers more than 70% of our final CA FR syllabus. And the second reason is being a future chartered accountants. We will be the future chartered accountants and we have to help a lot of corporates in implementing the Indian accounting standards. So since my co-speaker Varsha had dealt with the implementation and roadmap to Ind AS, now I'll be dealing with the key differences between Ind AS and accounting standards. So this is the agenda for today's discussion. We'll just on a note, overall basis, we'll discuss on the implementation of Ind AS. We'll see the bird's eye view of the difference between AS and Indian accounting standards, and we'll be dealing with few more differences between AS and Ind AS. So the bird's eye view, to sum up the massive change, the bird's eye view of the difference between AS and Ind AS is, Ind AS has two components now, which are changes to the existing accounting standards, and there are completely new accounting standards, which are Ind AS 29. There is a separate standard on hyperinflationary economies, which was not there in accounting standards, and there is a separate Indian accounting standard on investment property, which some portion of it was there in AS 13 investments. For agriculture, we have a separate standard, Ind AS 41. And 101 is an important standard because it will help the companies for adoption of Ind AS. Share-based payments, we used to have a guidance note on share-based payments, but there is a separate standard on share-based payments. Insurance contracts, exploration and evaluation of mineral resources, there is a separate standard on it. And like Mohan sir mentioned, this is the major change, a biggest Indian accounting standard, financial instrument, and fair value instrument. So today we will be dealing with the changes to the existing accounting standards. So we'll begin with first change, which is AS 5, net profit or loss for the period prior period items and changes in accounting policies. The same has been changed to Ind AS 8 and renamed to accounting policies, changes in accounting estimates and errors. So, the first and key difference between AS 5 and Ind AS 8 is presentation of an additional balance sheet at the beginning of preceding year. In IGAAP, have we ever presented an additional balance sheet? We used to give a comparative periods. Have we ever presented a balance sheet on the beginning of the preceding year? Come on, people. Have you ever presented? But Ind AS requires us to present an additional balance sheet. If the company has changed its accounting policy in the current year, if the company has reclassified some captions in the current financial year, or if the company has prior period items in the current year. So, And there is one more difference, like we spoke, the prior period errors. If we have any prior period errors in the current period, the company has to go back to that year, change the numbers, and present the additional balance sheet with restating, with changing those numbers retrospectively if the prior period errors are material. So we'll have an example on this. The company was following FIFO method for valuation of inventory. Now the company has changed the valuation of inventory method from FIFO to LIFO. Is this a change in accounting policy? Come on, answer. Absolutely correct. This is a change in accounting policy. The company has to restate the previous year's numbers and present an additional balance sheet with giving effect to the LIFO method of inventory valuation. One more example. The company was following SLM method of depreciation and changed to WDV in the current year. Is it a change in accounting policy?
No.
Come on.
No.
Why is it not a change in accounting policy? Come on. Exactly. This is a change in estimate. This is the biggest difference in Ind AS and accounting standards. In accounting standards, depreciation was accounting policy, but in Indian accounting standards, depreciation is a accounting estimate. So this is not a change in accounting policy. And in IGAAP financials, we used to see one line, prior period errors and extraordinary items. What are those extraordinary items? Example? Examples like insurance claims, sale on profit of a business unit, those are the extraordinary items, right? In Ind AS, we don't have such concepts. The company cannot show any income or expense as extraordinary items. So let's move to the next accounting standard, which is Ind AS 17 and AS 19. AS 19 has been renamed to Ind AS 17 and it name is still same, but the standard name number has been changed to 17. So the difference, the key difference in this accounting standard is exclusion of land leases. Land was never part of accounting standard. Land we used to always show in balance sheet. It was not subject to assessment. But under Indian accounting standard, we have to assess for the land. If the land is pertaining to finance lease, then only we can show it in the balance sheet. If it is not pertaining to if it is pertaining to operating lease, then we should not show the land. Think logically, finance lease, at the end of finance lease, the risk and rewards, the still lesser and lessee becomes the owner of the property. So there is a logic, it makes sense to show the land in the balance sheet. But operating lease, after the expiry of lease term, there is no connection between lesser and lessee. You're not supposed to show the land. And one more key difference is straight lining. All that complicated calculations what we used to do, straight line rent, rent equalization reserve, unbilled revenue, that is not there now. So Ind AS 17 specifically says if the escalation percentage is in line with the general inflation, the company need not do straight lining. Think about the impact of this change, people. When the company, suppose say rent for the first year is 10 rupees, second year 11 rupees, third year 12 rupees. The company used to allocate equally over the 3 years. But now if 10% is a normal general inflation, so the company used to show a notional, it's not notional, but used to recognize the rent which is going to pay in the subsequent year, in the current year, under accounting standard. But now if it is in line with inflation, the company cannot do that. The company has to show the actual rent paid or rent received. Because by doing this under accounting standard, the company used to violate conservatism principle. Suppose a leasing company will have crores of rentals every year. the escalation percentage will be 10%, which is normal. So the company used to show additional, which is going subsequently what the rent will be receiving by the company, that will be there in the revenue from operations. So that is a violation of conservatism principle, which Ind AS doesn't allow company to show that. If the escalation percentage is aligned with inflation, the company cannot do straight lining. Lease in substance. This is also one of the key change, which is no guidance on arrangements that do not take legal form of a lease. Arrangements, Ind AS says, arrangements that do not take legal form of a lease, but fulfillment of which dependent on the use of specific assets and which convey the right to use the assets are accounted for lease. What is it? I didn't understand. Have you understood? Let's see an example for this. Mr. A, he is an automobile manufacturer. Mr. B, he is a job worker. And the details are given below. Mr. B manufactures components of machines upon the specifications of Mr. A. Mr. A controls Mr. B. Mr. B uses assets, including premises of Mr. A, to produce the machinery components. Mr. A pays per machine piece job work charges to Mr. B. And Mr. B provides job work services only to Mr. A. What is the treatment of the transaction? Any answer? You want to see the question again? Mr. B manufactures specific components for Mr. A. Mr. B is controlled by Mr. A. Mr. B uses assets including the premises of Mr. A. Mr. A pays per machine job work charges to Mr. B, and Mr. B provides job work services only to Mr. A. What is the accounting treatment? What is the treatment of this transaction? Any answer? Come on, guys, any answer? No answers. Come on. I heard some answer. What? No. The answer for this is Mr. A becomes the lessor, Mr. B becomes lessee, and the transaction should be accounted as per Ind AS 17. So that is the biggest change. In accounting standards, we used to treat this as subcontracting. So the expenses incurred by Mr. A will be treated as subcontractor charges. But Indian accounting standard 17 says the transaction is a lease transaction, should be accounted as per Ind AS 17. So now let's read that and we can understand the same. No guidance on arrangements that do not take legal form of a lease. Legal form of a lease. This takes the legal form of a lease. So Ind AS 17 says, arrangements that do not take legal form of a lease, but fulfillment of which is dependent on use of specific assets and which convey the right to use assets are accounted for as leases. So in this case, Mr. A has control over Mr. B. Mr. B is providing services only to Mr. A, and he gets monthly job work charges. So this transaction should be accounted as per Ind AS 17. And one more difference between accounting standard 19 and Indian accounting standard 17 is indirect cost, initial direct cost of lessors for assets under finance lease or operating lease. What was the treatment of in AS 19? Suppose say initial direct cost incurred by lessor, suppose say brokerage expenses incurred by lessor, what we used to do under accounting standard, what is the treatment of that? We had two options. Of one option is recognized immediately in the profit and loss account. Second one was allocated over the lease term. But Indian accounting standard says we have to assess the charges are pertaining to which lease. If it is pertaining to finance lease, it is included as a part of interest rate implicit in the lease. So finance lease, we will be accounting as an interest expense. We will be calculating the percentage. you know, IRR, right? Internal rate of return. So we'll be calculating that percentage, and these charges are considered in calculating that IRR percentage. And if it is pertaining to operating lease, the expenses, the initial direct costs which the lessor has incurred are to be added to the carrying value of the leased asset, and that will be amortized over the period as depreciation. So the next accounting standard and Ind AS we'll be dealing is AS 12, accounting for government grants, versus Ind AS 20, accounting for government grants and disclosure of government assistance. Can anyone tell one difference by looking at the name? What is the difference, key difference? Disclosure of government assistance. Exactly. The name itself says account. AS 12 was only accounting for government grants, but Ind AS requires the companies to disclose the government assistance received. So, government assistance, examples are like MEIS, Merchandise Export Incentive from India scheme. So the merchandise income, whatever we get when we export, that is a government assistance. So that we have to disclose in the financial statement. It's not a government grant, but that we have to disclose in the financial statement. In IGAAP, we never used to disclose government assistance. That is the key difference. And scope. One more difference is waivers from government are not considered as government grants in accounting standards. But Indian Accounting Standard 20 says waivers from the government qualify as government grants and to be accounted as per Ind AS 20. It's substance over form. We have to see the substance. We have to see the substance over form. If the waivers, suppose say, I'll give an example, interest-free loans, that concession loans, what government gives. So that concession is to be qualified as government grants, and it should be accounted as government grant. So the next difference is measurement of non-monetary assets. Suppose a non-monetary assets like land. Farmers get land, right? Farmers get free lands, right? So if that land is for free, accounting standard used to say record it at nominal value, like 100 rupees, 1 rupees, 10 rupees, nominal value. But Ind AS 20 says it should be accounted at fair value. Imagine if farmers had to prepare books of accounts. What is the amount? What is the biggest change from 10 rupees, 100 rupees of accounting land to fair value? And if the company is, if the consideration is at concessional price, the actual price is to be recorded under accounting standard. But now under Ind AS, we have to record it at fair value. And recognition in natures of promoter's contribution. So under accounting standard, we used to credit that government grant, whatever we received, if it is in the nature of promoter's contribution, directly to the shareholder's fund. But Ind AS prohibits of recognizing a reserve. Ind AS says create a deferred income and allocate it over the years. Concessional rate loans, this we have already discussed. AS 12 doesn't have any guidance on the treatment of such loans, but this concession should be accounted as per Ind AS 109. The recognition criteria for various assets, in AS 12 we had three options. We can set up a deferred income, or we can reduce the grant from the asset carrying value of the asset, or if it is related to non-depreciable asset, we used to show the grant as capital reserve. But Ind AS prohibits from showing as a reserve. Ind AS only requires setting up it as a deferred income and allocate it over the coming years. Borrowing cost. The next Ind AS and AS difference what we'll be discussing is borrowing cost. So borrowing cost scope exclusions. Ind AS 16 never had a scope exclusion, but Ind AS 23 have some scope exclusions, which are, if the qualifying asset you are recognizing it at fair value, you need not apply Ind AS 23. Because under AS, what we used to do is, we used to add the borrowing cost to the book value of the asset. But when you are recognizing the asset at fair value, that borrowing cost portion will already be considered in the fair value. So you need not account separately for the cost. And inventories that are manufactured or produced in large quantities. So if it is unallocable, the cost, if you are not able to allocate, you can recognize that in the inventories. And next difference is interest calculation. So interest calculation, we used to record the actual interest paid in the P&L, but now it suggests us to account the interest as per EIR method. You know IRR, right? IRR calculation. It is calculated as per discounted cash flow method, and we have to account the interest paid using EIR method. And foreign exchange differences on long-term foreign currency borrowings. Suppose, say, you have a real estate company has borrowed 100 crores of loan, foreign currency loan, before Ind AS transition. The difference, forex difference between that loan, under accounting standard, it used to be considered as borrowing cost. But Indian accounting standard prohibits, from the first year of Ind AS implementation, that foreign exchange difference on long-term foreign currency borrowings to be charged entirely to the profit and loss account. So the next and final standard what we'll be dealing is segment reporting. AS 17, we used to determine the segments using risk and rewards approach. So the risk and rewards approach are company specific. What the risk company has and what are the rewards it's going to be get in the future. Based on that, we used to determine the segments. But Ind AS 108 says to be determined by the CODM, chief operating decision maker has to determine the segments of the company and disclose. And there is a mandatory requirement of disclosing the segments, which is AS 17 never told us to mandatorily disclose the segments. It says if segment reporting is applicable for the entity, then entity has to classify the segments as primary or secondary segments. But Ind AS 108 says even if the segment reporting is not applicable to the company has to disclose the segments based on external revenue from each product or revenue from customers and geographical information on non-current assets. So by this we come to the conclusion slide, which is Ind AS and accounting standards and Ind AS, the impact is very huge. So we have to assess, we Future Chartered Accountants of India, we have to assess the impact of Ind AS and help corporates in implementing the Indian accounting standards. Thank you.
Okay, I understand that a little bit of impatience is going on because the people are clapping, you know, and all of you want to break for a cup of tea, I think so. No, but don't worry, tea will come in some time, right? It's not immediately. Now, I just want to sort of, first of all, congratulate both Varsha and Ayana for an absolutely brilliant presentation. See, the problem is that I think they've been working for the last, how many days now, 10 days on this? Yeah, 10, 15 days on this presentation. There are 39 applicable Ind AS standards with an average of 2 differences per standard. That makes it 78 differences. So to capture about 10 standards in about 20 minutes, as both of them have spoken about, I think is really a tremendous effort. So congratulations, both Varsha and Ayana. Actually, good effort, right? Now, for all of you in the audience, now that you know a little bit of the difference between AS and Ind AS, I'm assuming that you know whatever standards they spoke about. And I also spoke a little bit about Ind AS 109 being the main standard, which is, you know, will have a lot of difference. You can do this exercise in your office. I mean, if you just go take out any client's trial balance, and you in that particular trial balance, you start applying the applicable Ind AS, you will find that only one standard stands out as a majority. It will be Ind AS 109 financial instruments. because deposits, loans and advances, loans, trade receivable, trade payable, everything is covered under Ind AS 139. That standard will stand out. You will also apply, you know, whatever they are speaking about, those standards probably to specific transactions like government grants. You probably have one standard. Leases, you'll probably have one standard applicable. But the standout standard will definitely be, you know, 109. So maybe some other time you should probably look at 109 as a separate difference, because that's a channel which will obviously have a lot of impact. Now, the best thing about Ind AS is that once you finish this particular conference and you've taken the presentation from both Varsha and Ayana, you will feel that I know a little bit about Ind AS. Unfortunately, that's not true, because the standards are changing. He just spoke to you about Ind AS 17. Ind AS 17 is now going to change to Ind AS 116, which is probably going to come as early as 1/4/2019, in which the entire concept of leasing has been turned on its head. They are talking about the lessee showing any lease beyond 1 year as a right to use asset. So these standards are changing. Maybe probably in a couple of years' time, we may have some sort of a stability in terms of, you know, we would have probably had only amendments, or we'll have probably minor amendments to each of these standards. But it is a really interesting period for anybody who are doing your articles or who are studying to understand, because the International Accounting Standards Board, even today, feels that India is not IFRS compliant. Because we are having a small carve-out here and there, they still feel that India is not IFRS compliant. They are saying you will probably have to, you know, sort of tone down your carve-outs. We have already done removed some carve-outs. For example, Ind AS 40 investment property was not allowing us to do a fair valuation. That has been amended now to do a fair valuation. So I would probably assume that in a couple of years' time, we will probably, you know, be about 80 or 90% on par with the global accounting standards. And as all of you know, the reason, because why are we talking so much about IFRS in India today, is because it appears that there's a global movement to move towards one single set of accounting standards. And probably the biggest decision which US GAAP did was to permit non-US filers to present their financial statements in IFRS. I think that was probably one of the biggest benefits which the US GAAP has done. Therefore, US GAAP will only be applicable to US GAAP companies now, or companies incorporated in the US. The rest of the world will probably move over to IFRS. So in India, as we have seen, are probably about 70-80% there. We'll probably go in a couple of years back to 90%, or probably even 100% if, you know, things go well, right? So this is what I wanted to say. So I should thank Shravan and Srinivasa for giving me an opportunity to come here, chair this session. If there are any doubts on this session, please ask them, not me. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
I thank session chairman for sharing this session, and also thank him for his time and effort for sharing his knowledge with us. I thank on behalf of Bangalore branch of ICAI and SICASA Bangalore, our session chairman, C.A. Mohan R. Sir, and student speaker, Ayan Achari and Varsha Jain. May I request Varshita to present memento as a token of gratitude and respect to C.A. Mohan R. Sir. I request Varshita to present memento to the student speakers, Ayana Achari and Varsha Jain, as a token of appreciation. Thank you. This concludes the technical session on differences between Ind AS and AS. Thank you. Over to Vedant and Archana.
Thank you, Manoj.
Vedant, what's your favorite chocolate?
My favorite chocolate? It's got to be Kit Kat.
Yes, Kit Kat, break the one time, boss. Take a break.